Hello again, and welcome to our second series on capital budgeting. So in the first lecture series, which was broken out into two parts, we introduced various methods to capital budgeting, then we also discussed some of the cash flow issues in capital budgeting. So in this two-part lecture session, we are going to be discussing further issues in capital budgeting that are quite topical as part of understanding and evaluating investment decisions. So at the end of this lecture, should be able to evaluate projects with an equal economic life. You will also be able to adjust for the effects of inflation in capital budgeting analysis. Then we are also going to discuss how to rank and select projects under conditions of capital rationing. So I'm sure you can see that these issues, some of them are not necessarily addressed by the method that we discussed in the previous lecture session, that is the NPV, the IRR, modified the rate of return, etc. And we're also going to discuss the inclusion of the tax effects, especially tax losses on the capital budgeting decision. So to start off, projects with an equal life, what are these? So I can have project A and project B. Project A can have an economic life of 4 years, and project B can have an economic life of 6 years. And these projects are mutually exclusive. Remember the concept of mutually exclusive. If I accept A, I can't accept B. But from an evaluation perspective, because this project is about an equal life, I can then not automatically compare them. I then need to take into account the differences in their economic life. So how do we choose? So here, we then need to interpret in terms of relative NPV. Because if you look at NPV, it discounts the future cash flow at exact. So for projects that got different economic lives, it's going to distort their net present value. So NPV won't work to evaluate this project. So you need then a universal measure to ensure comparability. So as an example, I have a project X and project Y. Project X is 3 years and project Y is 6 years. So if you calculate their NPVs, project X is the positive NPV of 1.3, and project Y is the NPV of 1.7. If we use the pure NPV approach, Y is the higher NPV, so we accept. But if we then look at Y is 6 years, so it means the longer into time you go, you find the risk here in terms of generating those future cash flows, risk in terms of uncertainty. How accurate will you estimate those cash flows? So to make these two projects comparable, what should we do? We then need to say, for project X, we need to make it project it to have a similar economic life like project Y. So as an example, if there's an opportunity in reinvesting a similar period to Y in 3 years' time, then we can say in the third year, we are going to have another capital out of 5.2 and generate similar cash flow to what we generated for project X. Which then means for project X, now we have a life of 6 years, is going to have an NPV of 2.178, which if you then compare to the first example, is higher than NPV of project Y of 1.7. But the key underlying assumption for this method is, we assume that if in year 3, we are going to find an opportunity to reinvest in a project that is exactly the same as project X. Which practically, that can be a questionable assumption. So, going further to this, how then can you address some of these issues? So, we can compare project 2x with 1y. By what? By doing the discounting over the first 3 years for x plus the second 3 years to have 6 years project x. Then compare to this project y 6 years. So limitations, this is very difficult to apply to independent projects and also for failure that cannot be repeated. But remember in the third year for X, we assume that we are going to be able to reinvest a similar period to Y and generate similar cash flows. And then also for project X in the third year, we assume that our capital outlay in that stage will be similar to what we invested in year 0. But we will not take into account inflation. Generally, capital outlay required today for a same thing, will not be the same as the capital required 4 years from now because of inflation, current effects, etc. It also changes in technology. Plus, if you then look at these methods, they're not taking into account the risk that is minimized by inventing smaller projects with lower projects out there. So the project is a 6-year life. That's a long project and requires a bigger capital outlay. But if we look for a project, a shorter economic life for them, they require a lower economic outlay. And those advantages are not taken into account when we use this project evaluation tool. So how else can you address this problem? You can address this by using what we call equivalent annual annuities. So how do we calculate an equivalent annual annuity? So the first thing that we need to do is we need to calculate a project's NPV based on its initial useful life. So if we look at project X, it is 3 years. So we count the project's NPV over 3-year period. Then we also calculate project Y's NPV over the 6-year period. Once we have the NPV, the next step is we divide the project's NPV by the present value factor of an annuity for the period of the project. Obviously, you may ask, what is the present value factor? So I know most of us are not making use of our financial calculators when we do present value calculations, IRR calculations. But the underlying principle in those calculations is the PV table. So before we have these calculators, we need to have these present value tables. To say if I'm going to discount it 10%, in year 4, what is the present value factor? If it's a 5-year project, what is the present value factor? So from an examination perspective, when you are required to use this method, you will be given the relevant present value factors. Then the final step, you now follow the equivalent annual annuity. How do you do it? You take the NPV calculated, divided by the present values, by the project present value factor. So if it's a 3-year project, the PV factor, we are getting 2.3216. For project Y, the PV factor is 3.887. So what are the key drivers of this? Is that the PV factor is going to be the discounting factor used and the life of the project. Say, discounting factor of 10% with a project, right, with a project life of 3 years, you are going to get a different PV factor to your project in 3 years by using discount effect of 4 years. But like I said, this information you will be given in the exam should it be necessary. So from a decision making perspective, how do we may then make use of the equivalent annual annuity? So we then select the project with the highest equivalent annual annuity. So the reason why we are calculating this equivalent annual annuity is to make these two projects comparable. So if we then go back to our example, project X is an equivalent annual annuity of 0.5 and Y is between equivalent annual annuity of 0.4. So it means we need to select project X. But when you compare the absolute NPVs, project Y is the higher NPV. But from a comparability perspective, using equivalent annual annuities, we are coming to a different decision, which is now more appropriate. Then another method that we can make use of is the equivalent annual cost. So the previous method was equivalent annual annuity, now equivalent annual cost. How does this work? Here we convert the capital cost invested into the project to its equivalent annual cost. So for project X, the initial capital outlay we needed is 5.2 million. And then we divide that 5.2 million with the present value factor to get an equivalent annual cost of 2.23. Then project Y, initial outlay 8 million, divided by the PV annuity factor to get 2.057. So it means if there are annual cash flows for the both we understand, project Y will be selected Y because the equivalent annual cost is low. That is, initial investment required, then spread over the project life is lower than compared project X. But in practice, you then find for this equivalent annual cost calculation, Further adjustments will then need to be taken for capital allowances, which then reduce the real cost of the investment in fixed assets. So what effect are we trying to do by the equivalent annual cost calculation? We are saying an investment with a lower equivalent annual cost is preferable. Why? Well, definitely the initial capital outlay will be lower vis-a-vis the life of the project. Then, we want to look at special cases of cash flows. So, for example, we want to set the bid price. So, here, we've got a project. That means that as part of that capital project appraisal, we don't know the price that we should charge to get our inflows. But we know our outflows. So, the question is, how much should be the bid price? Effectively, we are saying the selling price is the unknown factor. How can you go about it? So let's use an example. What should be the selling price we should charge for a widget if you supply 10 units a year to XYZ Limited for 3 years? This widget will cost us 5,000 per unit to produce. If the company requires a new machine that will cost 150K and net working capital of 70K, the machine has no residual value and the discount rate is 4%. So for the purpose of this example, we want to ignore tax so that we focus on the core principles. So how do I go about it? Step one, we need to calculate the NPV without the cash inflows. So effectively, we are calling the NPVs of the outflows, being the initial outlay plus the future outflows. Once you have done that, so in our context, you should be able to get an NPV of 170.175 using discounting factor given in the example 12%. Then it means for us to achieve an NP, total NP of zero, our cash inflows must at least equal an NPV of 170.175. So effectively we are going to be doing some reverse engineering. So step two, then say what are these operating cash flows as an annual amount. So annual given is 3, that's our period. And PV will be negative 170.175. And future value is 0. And our discount rate that we use is 12%. So we don't need to calculate the PMT. So the PMT, here we are making use of a financial calculator. Put these inputs into your financial calculator to calculate the PMT, which is the annual cash flow, which gives us the 70,852. But remember that 70,852 is for the 10 widgets. So it means for each widget, we then need to have a profit of 70,885. So remember our PMT in this context is the net cash flow that we require to achieve the PV of zero. So then we calculate the selling price. We are going to say the net profit we expect from the sale of each widget plus the cost of producing each unit, which is 5,000. Then we get our minimum selling price of 4,100. So effectively, what we have done is to do some reverse engineering, and also we are assuming a cost plus pricing strategy to give us the minimum price that we need to calculate on this project to get an NPV or at least a zero. Then the inflation. So you find that normally the moment you project going forward, inflation then comes into play. Well, the price today, let's say something is selling for $5 today, next year it may be selling at $5 50, mainly because of inflationary pressures. So how do you take into account inflation? So you find that when you look at the discount effect or the required return, more often than not, that return will effectively take into account inflation. So that then brings about a practical issue that was being raised by the financial services in Zimbabwe. To say, for example, last year, December 2018, the month-to-date inflation was around 40%. But if you look at most instruments within the financial services sector, they're giving a return of between 13% to 20%. So it means effectively, those financial institutions suffered a loss Why? Because the return they were getting is below the inflation. So it means the return that they are expected to get should at least be above the rate of inflation. So what do you mean by nominal rent? So a nominal rent is the rate that takes into account the inflation. So I say from a formula perspective, you are saying 1 plus the new rate plus multiplied by 1 plus new rate, inflation rate minus 1. So to put this into context, if inflation rate is 7% and the real rate is 4%, then the nominal rate by applying the formula above, the nominal rate is 11.28%. That's why if you do the mechanics, you should be able to take into account to come up with the 11.2%. So for example, if you then look at the weighted average cost of capital, that's an example of a nominal rate. We are saying that one is already taking into account future possible inflationary pressures. Then, from a discounting perspective, if you are using nominal cash flow, that is, cash flows which are not inflation adjusted, you discount them using the nominal discount rate. But if you are using real cash flows, you also use the real discount rate. So real cash flows, effectively, we are saying those have not been inflation adjusted. For example, which are cash flows selling today's real prices, discounted nominal discount rate of 11%. So this is what would happen in the example. So we've got cash flow year 0 up to year 4. Then we put our PV factor to get our NPV. Then, if we take those same cash flows, but now using an adjusted due rate, so adjust future cash flow by inflation of 4.72%. So you are now taking into account the price things that are going to happen. And then we discount those cash flows using the nominal rate. We are going to get a positive NPV. Why? Because our nominal discount rate will therefore take into account inflation. So it means our cash flow that we use should also take into account inflation so that we use like for like. So in the example, we take just to keep the example simplified, because here we just wanted to focus. If you discount the real cash flows using a nominal rate, what would happen? If you discount the nominal cash flows using a nominal rate, what would happen to our net present value factor? So what I want you to do is to go to the next part of this video, which is part 2, where we are going to continue to discuss further issues in capital budgeting, mainly focusing on capital rationing and what it means on investment appraisal decision making. Thank you again for taking time to watch this recording. See you in part 2 of this lecture.